Good morning. You're now listening to Kingston Community Radio, airing on FM 92.5 and AM 920 WGHQ in Kingston, New York. This programming is brought to you by our listeners and corporate underwriters who are interested in presenting local community radio. The opinions expressed on this program do not represent those of PAML Broadcasting or Kingston Community Radio. Listeners are encouraged to send in $10 per month to help bring this program to you. Mail your contributions to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York 12402. For more information, or to donate online, visit our website at mykcr.org. And good morning. This is Dan Gatiss, starting us out here on a terrific Tuesday. It is Tuesday, August 31st, and it's 66 degrees starting out right now today. And we'll be right back after these messages.
Thanks for starting your day with Kingston Community Radio on 920 WGHQ AM Kingston and 92.5 W223 CR FM Kingston, New York. Magic 92.5.
The stigma of addiction is destroying lives across the country, preventing our loved ones from getting the help they need. We are Shatterproof, a national nonprofit dedicated to ending the stigma and devastation addiction causes families. We are changing laws, creating a community of support, and providing evidence-based resources for prevention, treatment, and recovery. Stigma shatters lives. Rise up against addiction now so another life isn't lost. Get involved at shatterproof.org/riseup.
Hi, I'm Steve Thomas for Habitat for Humanity Restore. Habitat Restores are nonprofit home improvement stores and donation centers that sell new and gently used furniture, building materials, and appliances to the public at a fraction of the retail cost. The Ulster County Restore at 406 Route 28 in Kingston needs your donations. Call our hotline at 845-853-7499 to schedule your free pickup. And thanks.
Hi, this is Dina Roy from Hurley, and I support the Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
Thank you for being with us here this morning on a terrific Tuesday. 7 to 9 a.m. we'll be with you, and every weekday, 7 to 9 a.m. We will not be broadcasting on Labor Day, though. Just a heads up for you for Labor Day. Weather and forecast for Kingston and the surrounding areas. Partly cloudy skies this morning, will become overcast this afternoon with a high of 82. Tonight, partly cloudy skies early, give way to cloudy skies late, and it's a low of 61. Wednesday now, we have rain showers. It's a 90% chance of rain will evolve into a more steady rain in the afternoon. Potential for floods. There is a flood watch, a warning for Wednesday, and a high of 68 degrees. Wednesday night, cloudy with periods of rain, 100% chance of rain with a low of 57 degrees. And that potential for floods continues throughout Wednesday and Wednesday night. Thursday, rain ending early and breaks of sun in the afternoon, a high of 72 for Thursday. Chance of rain in the morning is about 70%, but it will taper off, and we'll have some nice sun in the afternoon on Thursday. And Thursday night, clear, low of 54. And let's see, you're listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio. Let's listen. And we're streaming online at mykcr.org as well. The phone number to call in, your phone number to call in, is 331-9255. And let's get to the on-air studio with Nina Postupack and Cameron Rylance. Welcome.
On a terrific Tuesday.
It is a terrific Tuesday. Good morning. Good morning.
Out there in Radioland.
Yes. I hope everybody's enjoying this beautiful summer morning before Labor Day, or last week of the summer.
Yeah, yeah.
Nice and cool this morning. It's about 66 degrees right now. Nice and cool.
It's not.
It's a good.
It's very humid.
Yeah, blimey.
There's condensation on the outdoor window there from the air conditioner, so you know.
It's almost impossible to keep your windshield. You know what?
It is.
When you have this kind of temperature, it's really hard to keep your windshield clear.
Yeah, yeah, the side vent, you know, it's either blows in your face or you tilt it towards the window.
Right, exactly.
And you get this big, the oval of condensation, and it perfectly covers my side view mirror. And I constantly use my side view mirror as much as my rear view. and it's a pain in the neck.
It completely
obscures my...
your vision. Yeah.
It's like perfectly absolutely. Poorly designed, I suppose you could say.
So this is a fifth Tuesday of the month, right, Cameron? So we do have Lindsey Timber coming on at 8:30 to talk about Kingston Parks and Rec. But for the next hour and a half, you have Cameron and I, and we'll try to keep you updated as to what's happening around our community and what's going on. But please call in 331-9255 and share some of your thoughts and ideas since we do not have any guests other than Lindsey at 8:30.
So, how was your week?
My weekend was good. My week was good. We've been really busy at the office, which is a good thing. Everybody's trying to stay as safe as possible. Didn't like the headlines too much this morning.
Duchess case is going up sharply.
And I know our dashboard wasn't updated over the weekend. But, yeah. So, and on the Middletown Record, there is a map of New York State with all the counties, and every county within the state is there's none that are at a point where it's just minimal.
Really?
Yeah, they're all substantial. Or
all state? Even like upstate and everything? Like, yeah. Wow.
Yep. So everybody, please stay safe out there to the best of all of our abilities as we continue to try to live our lives and keep everything open and moving forward. And I know the kids going back to school next week is a little bit of a worry for everyone, but if we all stay safe, wear our masks, do what we need to do, I think we'll get through this. And they're opening the vaccination center again at Best Buy.
They are. I know there's one in the Kingston Plaza I saw.
Yep.
Went to pick up my Savona's to go last week and I noticed it, so.
Yeah.
The old Radio Shack.
That's what I was going to say. I think it's in the old Radio Shack.
The old Radio Shack.
Beautiful. Wonderful.
Yes.
Wonderful
yeah.
effort.
Yep. You know, I've never been tested.
I've been tested.
We had to
with
the
work
county.
And stuff.
But I've, not that I'm against getting tested. It just, you know, during the quarantine, I was, you know, careful, I thought. And as soon as I was eligible for the vaccine, I got it. And, you know, unless for scientific purposes, I suppose I could go get tested, or for, you know, tracking purposes. But
each time I was tested, which was I think three times, was because I came in contact with somebody at the office who had COVID.
So I made that.
If you're blessed that never happened to you, I don't see why.
Well, I worked alone.
You had the perfect job.
Dog, I don't think Luna had any COVID. So
I had an ambulatory. Operation. Yeah, colonoscopy, and then they tested you, you know. Yeah.
And they had to do it.
So you had to get tested?
Yeah, exactly. So it was the only time I had it.
Didn't like lion or a tiger at the Bronx Zoo test positive for COVID or something like that?
Oh,
yeah, remember hearing?
Yeah. Could be.
But which leads me to I made that statement. I didn't get it. So the people that are getting tested now that they're finding that the rate is going up, are those people that have symptoms or they've been exposed or like how?
I'm assuming.
Test subjects are getting positives or where are they coming from? You know what I mean?
So I think probably a couple different places. So I know they will not do a rapid test like an emergency one unless you are symptomatic. So if you want a rapid test at any of the facilities, you have to be symptomatic. So that's the first thing. If you have symptoms.
Symptoms.
Okay. They'll do a rapid test. The other thing is coming in contact with somebody who's had COVID. I think people are getting tested, obviously. And then the third reason, many employers are requiring weekly testing for those people that are not vaccinated.
So it's not just people walking off the street saying, I'm going to go get tested.
No, so, I don't think so.
But statistically speaking, as you're talking, I'm thinking about this. Yes. So if you're exhibiting symptoms, chances are you have it, I would imagine, right? I mean, better than 50-50 if you have... Sure. The cough. I can't taste my onion rings last night at dinner.
Yeah, running a fever.
So,
a couple of us at work had flus during the early spring. They went to get tested. It was negative both times.
Good.
But they were flu symptoms. Yeah. It's very similar. To the scare of COVID.
That's what they said. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, cough, stuffy, fatigue, whatever. So rambling around the corner here to get back to my point. So what the so if the majority or whatever people are, well, I guess not the majority. It seems like it would skew that number higher. If you have symptoms, more than likely you're going to be 60% chance of being positive.
Right.
To me, that would make the rate go seem higher than in the average population. Now, it's like you're testing at risk, or you know, if you're testing symptomatic people, chances are they have it, so they're more likely to test positive.
Right.
Which would mean, oh, if I did 50 tests today and 30 came back positive, that's a positivity rate of 70%, whatever.
Right, because
instead of 3.2. So I don't.
Well, I think because a lot of people are getting tested that aren't symptomatic because of requirements, their employers, or because they've come in contact with somebody who's had COVID. So I think I know what you're saying. If only people who are symptomatic were getting tested, then you would have a very high percentage,
it
and it would be skewed.
So, yeah.
Yes, but I think it is more of a broader sampling than just people that are symptomatic.
I sort of asked how the test subjects were. You know, how are they? What was the reason they're being tested? Just walking off the street or ordered? You know, I didn't think of the employers.
Yes.
You know, mandating that.
Yeah. I know the county does.
Well,
I know a lot of.
I mean, if the teachers, you know, between the community college and all the school districts in Ulster County, there's a lot of teachers out there. So that's a lot of tests.
Yeah. So. Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think that's a part of it. I read a statistic just recently that 50% of the country right now is vaccinated, just about close to 50.
Good.
I think 51.
Right.
So you have to keep it moving.
An interesting week.
Did?
I was off last week.
Oh, that's right. You had a week off.
Staycation. I was supposed to get into my wrought iron railing on my front steps, scraped and primed.
That's right. And you went fishing at the reservoir?
What? Yeah. Oh, my gosh. Phenomenal success at the reservoir. It was, we caught.
You've never done that before.
No. We caught, I'm not going to say where we were. We're in a lower basin. That's all I'm going to say. Road out, of course, when we get there, the weather forecast for days, calm, light and variable winds, whatever. As soon as we get there, there's like white caps. And of course,
I remember last Tuesday.
Murphy's Law, it was beautiful, it was nice, it was sunny, hot, but the morning was windy. At least it was on the reservoir. Murphy's Law, the wind is always going directly in the direction you want to go, or blowing in your face. You know, it hinders your progress. So it was a slog rowing out there. Get out there, you know, whatever. And it was really neat. We were in like 78 feet of water, and we're fishing at around between like 30. We're experimenting. We had four poles, 35, 40, 45 feet, and because that's where the temp, you know, it's colder water, you know, the
so
thermal climb. Because the surface temperature of the water was like a bath. It was like 72.
Whoa.
Because my buddy Mark had a portable fish finder, a little radar thing, you know, you clip to the side of the boat, and it also reads
does
surface
it work?
Temperature. Yeah, it shows stuff, you know, fish swimming by, you can ascertain the size of them, but that's about it, you know, and they're, it's
but it
more
gives
for their
you a
depth.
Feel. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, you know, they make sophisticated ones that can tell you everything, give you a recipe for the fish or whatever, but this is just, you know, a rough idea of the depth. So we caught a bunch of, like, three brown, we kept two, you're allowed to keep up to two fish, three fish a person, I think. We only kept one each. But we caught a couple of big fish, but we kept a couple of beautiful brown trout, well, one brown trout, and we caught two rainbow trout.
Oh.
And I guess rainbow trout are very rare to catch on
wow.
the Shokan Reservoir because they don't stock them anymore.
Okay.
So any rainbow trout that exist are either naturally repopulating or somehow survive many years ago.
Are you allowed to keep it?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah, anything you catch.
Okay, because I thought maybe with the rainbow, since
with
they
the
weren't
size,
restocking.
Yeah, they have to be the correct size, and, you know, you're allowed a limit.
Right.
So you fish until you find the right fish, and hopefully, you know, you don't injure any of them so they can return. But fortunately, you know, none did. Everything we released was gone. So we caught brown trout, rainbow trout, white perch, and we got four kinds of fish. What was the other one? Oh, smallmouth bass.
Okay.
Bunch of those, because they eat anything. They're like the jackals, or the hyenas, or the stray dogs. Okay. They eat even freshwater, you know, big lakes, little lakes, streams. Bass are like aggressive. They gulp down anything. But a fantastic day. delicious trout dinner that night. With the leftovers, I made trout cakes the next day. You know, like
red and bread,
like a crab cake, but with trout, delicious. But it was such a great time. You know, beautiful views, eagle. You know, I think it was the same one because it kept coming and going from the same spot.
Oh, that's nice.
Flying around overhead. You know, it's airy or whatever. We couldn't see it, but we suspected it was there because you know
right,
we're there
kept
for
flying
five
in that
hours
area,
out
yeah.
there. But yeah, great luck. And it was neat fishing. I've never fished, you know, like when you go striper fishing on with a downrigger in a boat, you know, there's like a, you know, a machine and everything. But this was like low-tech fishing. He had a mark on his poles a foot long. So, you know, and the weight, you know, you little like a ball, you know, half ounce weight that can slide on the string. And you have a leader, like from that weight, there's a longer, like a 3-4 foot long piece of leader. It's finer and finer than the regular fishing line, so this can't see it because trout are very smart.
Oh, okay. Smart fish.
You know, you have to, you know, trying to be invisible, and you're hooking on live bait. You know, we had to drive down to Tommy's Taxidermy in Kerhonkson to get it, and you know, you hook
live bait. What do you use? Worms?
Minnows.
Minnows.
Shiners, sawbellies, I forget which exactly one. But, you know, about 4 inches long, silvery fish.
They're alive when you put them on the hook.
You clip them through, like, near their dorsal fin, and you lower them down, and the trout sees it, and ooh, that's what they eat. I mean, they're, you know.
Yeah, yes.
You're trying to present it to them so they don't have to go looking for them. That's why, right. You know, you're fishing.
Gotcha.
So it was pretty neat, you know. So you had a little rod hole. So you just count, you know, 30 feet. You do 30 1 foot thing, 1, 2, 3. So, you know, you try to be accurate because there are what I learned was, you know, there's specific depths that of the temperature
that
and
they
current
live at.
And yeah. So, yeah, it was just cool. Really neat day.
Yeah, that's
learned
great.
About, you know, different technique of fishing.
Sure, yeah.
So, it's fun. Can't wait to go back.
Yeah, and when you think about it, you've lived here your whole life, and you're a fisherman.
Yeah, I fished on the shore like twice, you know.
But
never
yeah, if you lived in so if you lived in like St. Louis, Missouri, this would be an ultimate destination for fishing.
But,
right?
Apparently,
you know, and the know-how that you have on the Ashokan and the regulations with just rowboats and all that kind of thing is quite a destination.
Yeah, yeah. So it turns out we went to the Ashokan, you know, it's closer, it's a nice day and whatever. But the Papakton and Rondout apparently have much bigger fish in it. They grow bigger.
Mm.
Depth, you know, who knows why, but
interesting.
So I mean, he's got boats up there. It's interesting. He my buddy Mark, so I won't think of his last name, is like fishing partners with this guy who's been, you know, fishing for 50 years on the reservoir. And he has his key ring. He has like access to like 20 rowboats, several on each reservoir, you know, on different sides, depending on the wind or what type of fish. You know, if you're going to go bass fishing, you don't want to go here. You want to go over there.
So
you have to have boats. But I was shocked. The number of boats that are chained up to trees in the reservoir. There's only a few spots that are accessible to the road. I mean, you can do it pretty much anywhere. As long as you're in a legal parking area and you have your vehicle permit, you know, the DEC permit. You
can, the 28A is one.
Yeah, all along 28. Yeah. You know, you see the numbered spots. Some of them are like a mile from the road to walk in. But people have boats there because, like, they know a little secret fishing spot But most people where it's easy because you're carrying gear. You know, you got...
Right,
you know, a thing ball. For, you know, and there's no alcohol on the reservoir. I wasn't drinking anyways because day I had a nighttime thing, but zero tolerance for alcohol. So you can't
that's
even
smart.
Have a couple beers out there, which is good.
Yeah.
Less litter, probably.
Yeah, less litter.
And less
safer.
Less shenanigans and safer.
Right.
But I did not know that. I, you know, wasn't going
to
have
not
whatever. But like, if
do they patrol that pretty well?
Yes.
They do.
We saw a guy drive by, don't know if it was DEC or sheriff or whatever. But if there was one rowboat tied up, there was thousands. It was literally like a parking lot stacked up next to each other, willy-nilly. It was unbelievable. It was like, holy cow. Some of them have been there for a long time. Like you could tell these are boats from like the 50s, like AMF.
Oh, wow.
I don't think AMF has made aluminum rowboats since the 70s, literally.
And there are ones that are there.
You know, boats stamped Grumman with like the old logo, like they used to be on the side of buses and, you know, Grumman, you know,
sure.
Make airplanes, you know, whatever. But it was unbelievable. I was like, holy, and that was just the one spot near the spillway
Right, so that's just one area.
But, you know, there was others out there, and Mark's like, you know, over there is, you know, he's pointing out different areas. Like, it's really shallow over there. It's a big, good bass area because there's lots of weeds. And, you can see, you know, 100-something boats over there. And, you know, way across, he's like, you know, there's a real deep channel right in front of the spillway. Is I guess it's deep, or, you know, and, you know, you can fish right up on the edge of the concrete. And
did you see a lot of boats out there? Was it
one other boat towards the end of the day?
That's it?
It was, yeah. It was Tuesday, but, you know, we both had a day off.
Yeah, so. With all the boats that are there, first of all, they're pulled way out. So it's,
a lot of them, yeah.
They're pulled way out so that when you're looking at the reservoir, you really don't see the boats. You don't see them.
Not really.
Unless you get into the woods.
But they do, because you get like three, four foot waves up there. You get a real windy day or a storm.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
And when wind's blowing across, you know, a mile of water, it can kick up a 3 foot wave. And it's
whoosh,
you know. And if your boat's too close, it can, you know,
yeah,
you want it beats it up. And then ice in the winter.
Yeah, you want, they all seem to be pulled way up into about, you know, about 20 yards.
Yeah, up under the trees.
Yeah.
But I was just kind of, like I said, had never done it before, just sort of shocked at the.
So you had a good, so that was a nice day off,
yeah, awesome
right?
Day.
For your week off. Yeah, relaxing.
Beginner's luck. Probably the next time I go fish, you won't get anything.
Yeah, but that's okay, yeah.
Have that, man. I got some great pictures, but, you know, everyone's seen fishing pictures, but. And then, so that was Tuesday. And then I didn't do any of the painting. I didn't get it done.
No, yeah, that's all right.
Scrape. It was
you
too hot.
You shouldn't work on a vacation.
I know. That's what my rationale was. I worked hard all summer.
That's right. You should enjoy your vacation.
But Friday afternoon, 2 o'clock, me and my friend Kevin and his wife Vicky drove down to Asbury Park, New Jersey.
That was fun, that night to
the Stone Pony, which was actually kind of been on my bucket list. I've always wanted to go to the Stone Pony.
Yeah, sure.
Always heard about it. You know, it's world famous nightclub, you know,
right
there with CBGBs and, you know, Limelight. I mean, it's Stone Pony. It's where Bruce Springsteen was discovered.
So did it live up to your expectations?
Oh, yeah. Well, it was outside. I didn't even go in the building. It was in the parking lot behind a big, for the Boston to Berkeley tour, which is a recurring tour of Dropkick Murphys and Van Rancid, who's very popular. Everyone sort of the Dropkick Murphys. They're pretty popular.
Right.
Irish-themed sort of punk rock band out of Boston. Scott, not punk. Well, you know, they whatever genre you want to call it. Had a fantastic time. Great. You know, the weather was good.
Stayed overnight?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Stayed over the hotel. We get to the hotel, and we knew it was close. Or I didn't. They did. Because they'd been to Stone Pony before. We walked into the room. Oh, look, we got a little balcony. Walked down the balcony, and the venue, you could see the stage.
Oh.
Couldn't see it, but, oh, that's the stage, you know, the big thing.
Right.
So it was cool, you know, lucky, you know, coincidence, whatever. So, Grant, fantastic time. You know, because of the outdoor noise ordinance, the show was over at 10, you know, started at 6, first band was at 6, 3 bands. And Kevin had VIP passes, long story on that.
That's a nice way to go.
Yeah, and we were, you know, even sitting front row in a theater, you're not as close to the stage as, and we were right there. It was awesome, really cool. And I had a great time, great show. So afterwards, 10 o'clock, you know, still don't do
so.
Chain jumped in, you know, went and jumped in the ocean. Went to the hotel room, got our suits on,
jumped in the ocean.
It was beautiful.
It was warm.
It was dark out, but you can't tell because, you know, it's Asbury, there's lights and not like there's a boardwalk, but there's,
it's busy
beachfront and, you know. So you get back to the hotel and we hear like the reverberations of like dance club music, like boom, 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 boom. What the heck? You know, what loud?
So we get in,
open the lobby door, it's louder. The Empress Hotel in Asbury Park, 50s looking hotel, but up, you know, modernized, it's clean, pretty nice. Turns out there was a drag show there.
Oh my gosh.
Drag queens, whatever.
Yeah.
So we're like, let's go check it out. So we went down, and it was in a big, you know, big nightclub, big as St. Joe's, you know, huge, big open, you know, a couple bars, a couple levels. And there was a stage that, or catwalk, I guess. I couldn't tell if it was permanent, but it turns out this was sort of like a traveling show. Like,
okay.
They go to different clubs, and, you know, but they're at, during the summer, every Friday night, they're at this
Empress Hotel.
For Asbury Park. I guess it's famous for its show, whatever. But the rest of the year, it travels around different clubs, whatever. So extremely professional, you know, the lighting, sound system, the MC, and the lady, the performers, because when they're performing, they're ladies, they're, yeah, you know, in their character. You know, there was one, the first act that we caught, we walked in like after the third performer or whatever, was like 50s, and she gave like a monologue, like a Betty Davis monologue, mm-hmm, or from a movie, and then she broke into a torch song, like, you know, you know,
pardon my
singing listeners, but you know, pretty cool. I was, oh wow! And afterwards, you know, the people clapping, and people, you know, apparently they had like groupies or fans that follow them, and you know, the expression, like, you know, a gentleman's club, you know, you hand singles up to the performers after they do their act. These guys were handing 20s, like not one 20, like 2-3 fanned out 20s. So afterwards, you know, they'd walk around, oh, darling, thank you. Oh, hello, Miles, like knowing people.
People,
like,
that follow them. And
several $100. Like they walked around, like the one had her purse. And, you know, there was 10, 15 people handing her
money,
multiple 20s. You know, the next act was like a dance, like a 70s, you know, dance routine, you know, very acrobatic. You know, just a variety of types of
different, and,
you know, the gowns, and, you know, you could tell obviously hundreds of hours on these gowns, sequins, and the sewing, and your gloves, and, you know, these performers were like, looked perfect. I mean, you know, you've seen this.
It's a professional show.
Oh, yeah, like the hair and makeup, like, you know, up these up. I'm sure there's wigs or weaves or whatever, but like as intricate as, you know, Marie Antoinette, like with the layers and the gowns, and, you know, the woman who did a disco dance had like a very tight fitting thing, you know, slit.
Right.
You know, so she could, you know, she's doing kicks and splits and, you know.
Yeah.
Very, you know, physical, acrobatic dance, whatever. And, you know, the first one with the torch singing had like, you know, the you know, a million pleats in the skirt. I don't think it was a Marilyn Monroe thing because she didn't look like Marilyn Monroe. She looked more 40s. Like she had a mole, like, you know, what, you know, they used to, you know, the fake mole.
Yes.
And it was at the 50s, 40s, you know, the beauty mark or.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, the 50s.
That type 90s, of thing. Yep. You know, very heavy, like white powder. Betty
Davis.
No more wire hangers. I think it was that. The movie. No more wire hangers.
Yeah.
Mommy.
Oh yeah,
Mommy Dearest.
Mommy Dearest.
The mother. Joan Crawford. Now I think about it, she might have been doing a Joan. Yeah. Now I think of that monologue because she had that voice. That might have been doing a Joan Crawford.
I think you nailed it. Yeah.
And then didn't she have that?
She might have had that.
Beauty mark, whatever.
Yeah.
But anyhow.
Well, you had quite a vacation.
It was a trip.
My goodness.
And we were down there for like literally 22 hours.
That was
it
good.
Was a whirlwind.
Whirlwind trip.
It was awesome. Great trip.
Great way to end your vacation.
Yeah, it was
right?
Cool. That was Friday. Yeah, Friday into Saturday. It was great. It was a cool time.
And back to work on Monday?
Back to work yesterday, yeah.
Yeah, nice. Good. So you
back,
had a good week.
Now it's the cleanup. Last week, I was, you know, my assistant lawnmower guy was there. He worked, you know, his normal hours. But I got back and realized, like, all the summer camp stuff still everywhere, you know.
Yes,
sports,
all that
down by the basketball court, you know, there's hula hoops on the roof of the lean-to. And
you don't have 20 people to delegate it to?
Yeah, no, yeah, me. No, I haven't trained groundhogs to clean up yet. So,
oh, please.
But, you know, groundhogs. There's, you know, the water jugs are on some of the front, you know, the big thermos jugs are on some of the porches, and there's coolers on some of the tent platforms. It's like,
so you have a cleanup.
The last thing I felt like doing
on Monday
is like this. I didn't. I had other stuff to do. My boss is in town, so we're
doing a little bit
strategizing.
Yes.
So, yeah, it was
planning.
Yes.
Yes. For the upcoming
But
year.
That's still there. All that stuff's still sitting there, you know.
It'll happen, yeah, sooner or later.
Yeah. And, you know, now is the fun time. You know, now, like, actually, I should talk to Dalton. Not mowing after camp, like, you're mowing the lawn, you found, like, you know, a stray sock out in the middle of the soccer field, or, you know, a sneaker, just, you know, one sneaker by the
floor. You wonder how they went home without their sneaker,
you know,
right?
What did you do? You hopped home? You
what
know?
Did your mom or dad say?
Yeah, and there's
home.
Water bottles
your
everywhere.
Sneaker?
You know, I got a couple of nice water bottles, like the stainless steel ones, you know, the couple nice water bottles left over. Yeah, so
kids are notorious losing water bottles and their lunch bag.
Zippered lunch bags.
Yeah, I always remember that. My kids, where did your lunch bag?
Yeah, and Tupperware lids. You know, little container to go, Tupperware lids.
Yes. Give them away next year.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But I want the whole container, not just the lid. You have the case and not the lid.
So you don't have the whole thing.
Well. So, look at that. We chewed up a half hour.
Yeah, look at that.
So, I guess we'll go to break.
Thank you, Nina Postupack, Cameron Rylance. And this is a terrific Tuesday. You're listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, on AM 920, 92.5 FM. My name is Dan Gatiss, and it is Tuesday, August 31st, 65 degrees right now here in Uptown Kingston. And we'll be right back after these messages.
Thanks for starting your day with Kingston Community Radio on 920 WGHQ AM Kingston and 92.5 W223 CR FM Kingston, New York. Magic 92.5.
Hi, I'm Danica Patrick. Watching my nieces grow, play, and learn is amazing, but not every child gets to be carefree. 1 in 6 kids in the U.S. are hungry. This breaks my heart, and it's something that Feeding America is working to change. Each year, the Feeding America network of food banks rescues billions of pounds of good food that would have gone to waste and gives it to families in need. To help, visit feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
African American women die from breast cancer nearly 41% more than Caucasian women.
That's unacceptable.
Visit komen.org/unacceptable.
Together with Susan G. Komen, we're committed to reducing U.S. breast cancer deaths by half.
We're going to do it by 2026.
Visit komen.org/unacceptable.
Hi, my name is George Post from Ulster Park, New York, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you. Where else can you speak to your local representatives on the air and have your questions answered? So thank you, and support KCR.
Here with us here at Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. 7:32 a.m., 65 degrees here this Tuesday, August 31st. This upcoming portion of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Mid-Hudson Valley Federal Credit Union, 1099 Morton Boulevard in Kingston. And look for partly cloudy skies this morning and become overcast later this afternoon with a high of 82. Partly cloudy skies will give way to cloudy skies late tonight and a low of 61 for tonight. And Wednesday, rain showers in the morning, evolving into more steady rain in the afternoon, potential for floods, high of 68, 90% chance of rain on Wednesday, and same Wednesday night, 100% chance of rain, cloudy with periods of rain, potential for flooding rains again, and a low of 57 for Wednesday night. Let's get back to the on-air studio with Nina Postupack and Cameron Rylance. Welcome back.
And we are back.
We're back.
And yeah, to our little off-air chat. And
yes, yes, and we're guest-free, right, Cameron?
Yeah, another hour.
Yeah, so please call in 331-9255.
So we have some, but first, yes. We're just talking off the air and about work and my vacation. And unfortunately, I'm going to lose some vacation days because I have to take 12 days from now and the end of September. And
yes.
For starting like 6 years ago, you know, when I started encountering this problem, I could carry over. I got paid for unused sick days. And they're like, oh, next year, all right, we can't do that, you know.
So now
next year's
you have
the last
to...
year where you're going to get paid for your unused sick days. Or PTO, personal time off.
Yeah.
So, okay, cool, fine, I'll use it. So that
How
year,
much time do you get?
That was like, they paid me for like a week or something, like 3 weeks pay. All right, next year's the last year we're doing that. We got to phase it out. So then a couple of years, I could bank it.
Okay, that's nice.
So then, which gave me like 7 weeks time off.
Yeah, that's hard when you don't use
it. So a couple years,
like,
look, you can't bank it. So like, okay, starting next year, which is like last year, they're like, you're going to lose it. Use it or lose it. Sorry, you know, it's your dang vacation. Use it.
Right, right.
You knucklehead. So I lost like 5-6 days last year. No biggie. Whatever. Probably the same thing's going to happen this year because of, you know, my workload or my guilt or my need to keep getting things done. I don't know.
Yeah, we were
or
talking.
Or my inability to go away on foreign exotic vacations. Can't afford it. Whatever. If I could go to Bali, I'd take 2 weeks. I'd go right now for 2 weeks, but I can't. But we were talking about the Americans' work ethic, and your daughter, you know, works internationally, and
right.
Americans are the only idiots who work. Who would lose vacation time or work?
Yeah, my daughter and I were having that discussion just recently, and she works for a global recruiting company. And the thing that she realizes or sees is that Europeans, you know, UK, France, people over in Europe take their vacations, and it's predominantly British company that she works for, and they feel it's. It's entitled to them, and they should do it. Where the Americans that work for the United States work for the company really, really struggle to take their time. They work 24/7, and that's not to say the work ethic of the Europeans is not a good work ethic. When they're there, they work and they work hard, but they believe in their vacations and they believe in their time off.
Yep.
And she said, and you'll see, Americans will get burnt out as opposed to Europeans. For taking their time and so forth and managing it much better. So it's interesting. It's an interesting.
My cousin Rob, my dad's sister's son, has lived in Netherlands for 20 years. They work for American companies. But in the Netherlands, you know, when in Rome, do the Romans. In the Netherlands, they work, you know, the Netherlands legal system, you know, whatever. But they had like, everyone in Netherlands, you get like these, like, employment, when you work for a company, you get like, they're assuming you're going to work here for the rest of your career. So you have a contract, like a 15-year contract. So in, you know, 2021, you're making this much and you have this much time off. In 2025, you're going to get a bump to this. It's like a guaranteed contract, and it's in writing, and it's...
Yeah, it's completely
different. You know, there's no layoffs because here's my contract. Look, you know, 8 years from now, you're like, look, I'm due, to make 90 grand this year, you know, 40, whatever the number is.
Almost unheard of in this country. And feel the security. I felt the security when you explained that. I felt the security for that person and their longevity and everything like that. Just the mental health of knowing that maybe next week you're not going to get kicked off.
Yeah, because you're protected by, you know, the Dutch labor laws and fair hiring and, you know, transparency, whatever you want to call it. But that blew me away when I heard that.
Yeah,
you know,
that's amazing.
Years ago.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yep.
Yeah, completely different attitude.
The Dutch.
Yeah, that's for sure. Dutch. So we had talked about having Mark Cazapoli on. He's the director of Veteran Services for the county. And unfortunately, he wasn't able to make it today. There was a conflict. But I think we should talk a little bit about the salute our heroes, a tribute on 9/11 that's being done by the county. So this is the first time the county is actually holding an event on 9/11. And, of course, we all know it's the 20th anniversary of 9/11. So at the county fairgrounds on Saturday, September 11th, of course, from 4 to 9 p.m., there'll be a 20th year anniversary to remember and honor the survivors and first responders and to pay tribute to those who lost their lives on that tragic day. Admission is free. And donations will be accepted. There'll be music, food, and honored speakers to commemorate all of our heroes. Proceeds will benefit the Hope for Heroes project to combat first responder and veteran post-traumatic stress. It should be a really not only fun afternoon and evening, but also really a commemoration and a dedication to those that lost their lives and those that were there and the first responders on that day that none of us will forget. And in addition, Mark just sent yesterday that they're going to do, it's growing every day, they're going to do a memorial ride prior to the event.
All right.
So let me just tell you a little bit about that also, which is really exciting.
Because there's a couple big, in Ulster County, motorcycle clubs that are, you know, veterans are very active, raise money, you know, supportive. They show up to work to do, you know.
Yeah,
I can't think
absolutely.
Of the name. I know a couple guys that ride with them, and unbelievable the amount of camaraderie, solidarity is more accurate, of some of the motorcycle clubs. So
it's probably going to be huge. Yeah, so it's going to start. They're going to meet at the American Legion Post 1748, which is on Old Stage Road in Lake Katrine, 12 Old Stage Road to be exact, at 3 p.m. And then at 3:30, they will go from the American Legion right to the Ulster County Fairgrounds. And for more information, you can go online to, and I'm going to say this slowly, legionriders1298@gmail.com. That's legionriders1298, all one word, @gmail.com. So it's growing by leaps and bounds the whole day and the celebration and so forth. So
it's like a snowball. It's more people get involved. And
right, exactly, exactly. And I know also that there'll be events, of course, as there always are.
Are there any speakers?
There are speakers. I'm not certain who will be speaking.
And is there an official ceremony, a time for official ceremony?
That's a good question. That's a good question, Cameron. I'm not seeing a special time. Unfortunately, if Mark was here, we could have gotten a little more information on it. But yeah, if you go on the actual county website, you can, let me just look at this flyer also, which he has attached and sent to us with information. It doesn't give a time for an actual program or who the speakers will be. But go on the Ulster County government website. You can click on the Veterans Administration, and I believe there'll be quite a bit of information on there in regard to it. And I can't believe 20 years ago, right?
Mm-hmm.
When they were writing about the Marines that lost their lives over in Afghanistan this past week, most of them were in their early 20s or just 20. And so they were just born when 9/11 happened, if they were born. And when you think of that and you put that in perspective, it's just sad. It's very sad to say what happened over in Afghanistan. And we pray for those that lost their lives. Yeah. And we pray for their families, too.
I should have printed out and showed you a letter. In 2019, there was an Afghan girl at our camp. And she was selected because she's very outspoken youth activist, women's rights and ethics and human and her family is likewise too, pro democracy,
And we know
an Afghani citizen, not a radicalized Islam, ISIS or Taliban, we forget, it was 4 million people in Afghanistan?
Yes.
3.5 million of them are just like you and I. They want to go to school. They want our kids to be happy. Want to get married.
Right.
Want to have a good time. Want to have a little nice Sunday dinner or, whatever the heck.
Right, right.
It's the fringe, the extreme that is subjugating the whole country. And we can never forget that it's not the whole dang country. It's a minority, a radical minority. So anyhow, through some channels of art, where I'm actually writing a letter to Antonio Delgado as a constituent to see if there's any way he can
help
push, because the family has P-1 visa applications in, whatever, and our foundation is trying to figure out who do we know, how do we know, or whatever, any means possible to try to, so they asked me, because I live in Representative, camp is in Delgado's district.
And right, right.
I voted for him, and
I've
got a letter. Sent him a letter. But if there's anything he can do, don't know. But we're trying to get.
Oh yes.
Ask the State Department. Maybe he knows somebody that can just, because she's extremely, awesome girl. I mean, I know her. I met her. 2019. She was a 15-year-old girl,
And we know the plight that women face over in Afghanistan.
Exactly. And they're in hiding. So they're in hiding. They're in hiding because what her and her family has done, outspoken critics of the religious minority, they are potential targets for reprisal by a Taliban-led country. So, Yeah.
And there's
hits home, you know.
It's, well, yeah, and I was just going to say, there's an example of someone that you've met and that you know personally and is facing those circumstances right now. And you, when you explain, you can understand why they were trying to, at the airport, you know, those pictures of them hanging, desperate for hanging onto the planes and so forth. And you understand that for them, they are willing to risk their lives to get out of the country because
they know what's going to happen. Yes, they know it's coming.
Exactly right. So a very sad situation. Yeah. And you know, you look around right now and you see how about the hurricane that hit Louisiana exactly to the day that Katrina hit?
Yep.
Isn't that really I don't know, just an unbelievable occurrence that it was the same exact day.
Yeah, yeah, but thank goodness it wasn't as bad. You know, just a little bit of a few miles worth of difference of where the hurricane was, and I guess the timing. I guess that's everything. The timing of the tide.
Yes.
If you're high tide when the storm surge hits, you know, boy, good luck. But
yes. Yeah, thank God for those people.
Yeah. Goodness. And Lake Tahoe.
Yes.
My friend,
gosh.
Kirsten Duane, she lives in South Lake Tahoe. Her husband, Tim, and her kids. I just saw it this morning. It was too late to. I got to shoot her tech. Well, it's earlier, but
they're fleeing from the fire. Yeah, the wildfires.
And she lives in South Lake Tahoe. That's her address, mailing address, South Lake Tahoe. And I've been to her house, but oh my gosh, it's
very frightening. Very frightening. Absolutely. Yes.
You know, this isn't corny, but perhaps fleeing for their lives. You know?
Oh, absolutely. No, that's the truth. You know, wildfires come so quickly and so fast. And I think the devastation of their homes, everything that you've built your whole life on,
everything,
could be gone within minutes. And you're just really hoping that you save your own life.
Yeah.
And all your possessions may be gone if you can just save yourselves.
2 years ago, was it? The Paradise, California?
Yeah.
A woman lived in Kingston. She joined the Elks Lodge, Allison Bay. She has since moved to Florida. But she was a lodge member when that was happening. And she had family. Her uncle's house burned. The house she grew up in was, you know, damaged. Her parents had to flee. Kids she went to school with, or, you know, friends, you know, a couple died.
Yeah, it's frightening, it's sad.
You know, whatever. It's to know someone that has...
face that.
Another buddy, now that I think of it, he posted on Facebook a couple years ago, John Schwartz, Diane Nids. They're Kingston people. They ended up getting married later in life. They live out in San Francisco. Diane's a banker. They have a weekend house up in the mountains. Redwood, maybe? I don't know. But during COVID, when her banking job was closed, they worked remotely. And they've been up there ever since because it's a heck of a lot nicer. And they had the mandatory evacuation a couple weeks ago.
From the wildfires?
Yeah. And so they had to move back to their apartment in San Francisco, whatever. But, you know, posted online, you know, might be the last time we see the house. You know, good luck, everybody. We loved you, you know.
Absolutely.
They took a selfie in front of the front door or whatever. And it was like, wow, imagine
not knowing whether you'll come back to your home again.
Holy cow. I can only fit what I can, and you know they got a Subaru or something. I don't know what they drive, but
yeah, devastating.
I can only save whatever I can fit in this car, and we got to go.
Right?
Imagine that.
No, I really can't.
No.
So I'm thankful for all that we have.
You know. But,
yeah, the hurricane comes. Sure.
It's like, okay. Get whatever you got fits in this car. We got to go now.
Right.
You know. Whoa. The dog, the wedding photos, the legal albums, the whatever.
Yeah, they said this.
My box of baby remembrances, my kids' records. You know, what do you grab? You know.
Yeah, no, absolutely. They said this hurricane came so quickly. I know the mayor of New Orleans said that they didn't even have time to do a mandatory evacuation because it happened so quickly and so fast. And they're just saying, if you have the ability to leave, please leave.
Get out.
Yeah. So, yeah, you don't know the natural disasters. A couple weeks ago, I don't know if you, but my phone came across with a tornado watch,
five o'clock in the morning.
And
thank God I had left it downstairs and it didn't wake me up.
Didn't wake you up, yeah.
6:30, whatever, but it was.
Yeah, it woke me up. But I think of those people, seriously, in areas where tornadoes are prevalent. And I think to myself, you go down in the basement and you don't know if your whole house is going to collapse on you, or you don't know what's going to happen or what's going to be gone. Of course, I woke up Dwayne, and Dwayne's like, no, this is, he looked at the radar, this is already past us, go back to sleep. I couldn't go back to sleep at that point. But anyway, so of course that fear wasn't there. But in many places, in many states, when that tornado comes across, they don't happen in storms, really.
You know, the majority of tornadoes happen because, you know, clouds. It's not like it's storming and a hurricane and there's flooding.
No, right.
Middle of the night, they happen.
Yeah,
you know,
those winds, they say something with the circular motion of those winds.
Yeah,
yes.
It starts twisting in the air, and then because of whatever.
Even in our area, though, but it was very, very
localized.
In our area, it was just extraordinarily comforting to get that warning. You know? I mean, mm-hmm. We live in the Rondout, and that's very, very hilly and cliffy. And
it's actually much safer.
Yeah. So, we kind of passed over that. Yeah. We didn't think too much of it. But, in some flat areas of Kingston, it could hit.
Yeah. Travel a mile down Albany Avenue.
It's very, very good. It's a nice assurance that those warnings do go out.
Yeah. When it's the real deal, yeah.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
But you see, we've all seen the footage of, the path, I'm not making fun of it, but some little crossroads town in Iowa, you've seen these aerial footage and, you can see it comes through the cornfield and it's ripped bare, across the road, the gas station is destroyed, back across the farm field to the barn, the silos are gone, but right across the street from the gas station, there was a Motel 6 that, not touched or whatever. It's like,
Yes. Yeah. When my son was up at Springfield College, they had a tornado go through the area. And it's amazing. You're absolutely right. You could actually follow the path. And everything on either side was absolutely fine. And right where that path was, you could see the trees that were completely
stripped.
Yeah,
bare.
Right from their roots.
That was very unusual in Springfield.
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing.
That was quite unusual. So,
Natural disasters, the power of nature.
The most powerful force out there.
Yes, and we can't control it. We cannot control it. So, a lot of things happening throughout our country and throughout the world, which is frightening. So
have no events on the fold or anything.
No.
Upcoming, I might as well put a shameless.
Oh, yes. I'm sure it's an Elks
plug-in for our
dinner.
next Elks drive-through dinner, which will be, the first Monday of September is Labor Day. So we're not doing it on Labor Day. So it's actually going to be on the 12th.
Okay.
So it's Monday the 12th, starting at 5 o'clock, I drive through ham, baked ham, macaroni and cheese, and carrots.
Well, I love baked ham.
Well, if you call, this is where I had to run to the car, 428-9850, make a reservation.
Okay.
We'll have a hot, delicious ham dinner for you.
And what time can I pick that up?
Pickup starts at 5 to 6, but most people pick it up at 5 on their way home from work or dinner. It's dinner time. But August 12th, Monday, August 12th, 5 o'clock, the Elks, Kingston Elks Lodge.
And that's $10, right?
Yep, $10. The best deal in town.
And what's that number again, Cameron?
428-9850. And Paula, if you're listening, make sure you call and make your reservation. Shameless plug. We'll get another one of these plugs in there.
So now this has been going on for over a year, right?
Over
because
a year.
It started during the beginning of the pandemic.
Yeah, we started weekly and
we've been doing
monthly for quite a while.
Hey, when's the Hooli?
The Hooli is on Sunday.
Yes. Get down to the Rondell. Get down to the Strand.
Yeah, you're right. The first post-pandemic full-on festival.
Full-on festival.
That's exciting.
Get some great Irish music and dance.
And I saw Bill Yash. They're honoring Bill Yash.
Yes, what a wonderful man.
What a great guy. I'd never had him, but he was teaching career overlapped my student career. And nice guy.
Great person. Committed to the community.
Yep.
Yeah, so it'll be a fun day.
I saw that ad in the paper, full day of lineups. I mean, there's like two stages with 10 bands each. It's unbelievable. There's a ton of entertainment from storytelling. Karen Pillsworth will be
there. Right, yes.
To, you know, the Wolf Tones, to, you know.
Yeah, the Makana Band, yeah. A great day. It's you know, it's really a wonderful way to end the summer, Labor Day weekend, and I believe this is like their 21st.
It's a lot of them.
Yes,
it started as just a little old thing, and now
it's grown
buses
and
come
grown.
In from, you know, Hibernians and Celtic associations from all over.
Yes,
you know, because there's a bunch of pipe bands. You know,
absolutely.
Hammer Scots will be there. Being of part Scottish descent, Friday night at the Elks Lodge is a Irish-themed happy hour.
Oh, so, that's great.
And I don't mark my words, but I want to say, no, I'm not even going to say it, who might be bartending, because I'm not sure. But
okay.
Someone we know, someone, she's a frequent guest on our radio show.
I have an idea.
Her brother, who happens to be a firefighter, might be manning the the old Blarney Stone Bar.
Yes,
there.
Who have quite a bit of Irish blood in them. Yes, yeah. Yep. But, so that's great. Yeah, that's really, you know, it's just a fun weekend from start to finish, and a lot of work goes into it.
Ooh,
yeah. By the time the Hooli's over, they're starting to plan for the next year's one. So just like the parade, same thing.
Yep.
So it's nice to see the festival back, and hopefully it's supposed to be a beautiful day on Sunday.
Yeah. And Labor Day, it being late, this weekend also, Saturday this weekend, my boss was up, she had a few friends, they had a little weekend, some alumni, whatever, at camp, and three of the people there are New York City principals, coincidentally. For some reason, a lot of principals come out of our program. And New York City schools don't start till like the 13th.
My nephew teaches down the city.
Rosh Hashanah is like Tuesday or whatever, so they're like not going to start the first week.
I don't believe they start
till
the 13th.
Yeah, it's like, which is like, oh my gosh.
I know.
Traditionally, New York City schools like start before ours, but I guess because of the calendar and the holidays.
Yeah, and my son was in Connecticut. They started school
already?
Yesterday.
Yeah,
yes.
The Jersey schools too started already, I believe.
Yeah,
so.
Yes.
But they, you know, obviously if they're starting now, they're getting out in May, so.
Well, I know, but in Connecticut, they go right through till almost the end of June, too. Yeah,
break,
they must.
Longer, you know, like a week in spring break,
right.
Or like a week in fall break. Or, you know, they probably break it up more.
A little more, a little more.
Because you only need, or Connecticut's stricter than New York. They have more required school days.
That could be, too. You know, each
state
is different.
I think New York State is like it's 180 school days or something like that.
Yeah, 180. I think you're absolutely right.
Something.
Yes.
Connecticut could have a higher mandate or something. I don't know.
Yeah, so I know everybody's looking forward, especially kids, parents, to getting back to school, full day, in person, learning. It's what you'll, especially for the kids, I think it's great.
Hurricane Henri, was that since last Tuesday? Or was that before last Tuesday?
Because
two
know.
Friends of mine,
I think it was,
one of the guys.
I think it was Wednesday, wasn't it?
One of the people who are a principal lives in Far Rockaway, like, three houses back from the beach.
Okay.
And, you know, he had no storm damage. You know, but after Sandy, he had to, everyone had to, if you wanted your flood relief money or whatever, you had to raise your house 8 feet. Well, he went 11. So
good
for
him.
You know, there's nothing in the hot water heater. There's nothing in the basement. You know, it's designed to flood in an emergency. He was fine. The storm wasn't that bad. But my buddy Ron, who lives on Connecticut, is the Sound. He lives right on the beach in Westbrook. And on a normal day, all the houses in the same are all, like, on the water. The beach is, you know, 50 yards wide. At high tide, standing on his patio, which is only, like, a foot below his living room floor, the water is only, seems like, a couple feet below. You know, there's a slight arc to the beach slope, you know. It's only a couple feet. And the first time I was there, I was like, boy, a big wave would come right in. But it's a Sound. I guess they don't really get big waves, whatever. And they were saying, you know, 5 foot, I was watching news, you know, on the map, from, you know, where he was, like a 5 foot, they were expecting a 3 to 5 foot storm surge. And I'm like, ooh, 5 foot storm surge is going to put about a foot of water.
In his living room.
In his living room. And so I called him, and he didn't answer, which is odd, because he sees my number, either, you know, I'll call you later or whatever. didn't call. Like 3 hours later, I was like, uh-oh. And that 3 hours, getting a little nervous, and finally called me back. No problem. Storm surge happened to hit a low tide, but they were all prepared. You know, they put everything away.
Yeah, you're right. It's all about the timing.
Yeah.
There again, it's a perfect example.
Aren't you nervous? He's like, hell yeah, I'm nervous.
Yeah, I guess I am.
It's just luck, you know, knock on wood. When you take a chance to live by the ocean, you got to play by its rules. So.
Yeah, yes. And they did forecast quite a bit of wind and rain that didn't happen, which was great, which, thank God, especially along the Connecticut coast and up towards, and Long Island too, out towards Montauk. They were saying they were going to get hit you know, extremely high winds and so forth. So thank God that didn't happen.
Yeah, amen.
Yeah, that's for sure.
I mean, like, Vermont, what was it? It wasn't Irene. When we got flooded here, like, remember when Margaretville flooded?
Yes.
Andy, we got to go to break. We can talk about it after birthdays.
All right. Dan.
What storm was that? It wasn't a hurricane, but it was like a leftover rain.
Okay, and thank you, Nina Postupack and Cameron Rylance. And you are listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio. And it's a terrific Tuesday, WGHQ, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. It's now 8 o'clock AM, Tuesday, August 31st, and 66 degrees right here in Uptown Kingston. This last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Mid-Hudson Valley Federal Credit Union, 1099 Morton Boulevard in Kingston is their main office. Now let's get to the station break.
Thanks for starting your day with Kingston Community Radio on 920 WGHQ AM Kingston and 92.5 W223 CR FM Kingston, New York. Magic 92.5.
Hi, this is Tony Marmo from Norman Staffing, and we've been bringing together employers and job seekers since 1980. If you're an employer and have job vacancies, let Norman Staffing help fill them with permanent or temporary workers. We screen, interview, and recommend the best candidates for your company. We make the employment process easier and faster for you. Please call Norman Staffing for your employment needs at 338-9111, 338-9111, or normanstaffing.com.
Hey, hon, what you doing with your phone?
Do flowers have best friends?
I don't know.
Hey, look.
Whoa.
Some answers can only be found in nature. Discover the unsearchable. Visit discovertheforest.org to find a trail near you. Brought to you by the United States Forest Service and the Ad Council.
How do airplanes fly? What's in this box? What does this thing do?
Kids are curious about everything, including guns. Learn how to store your gun securely and make your home safer at endfamilyfire.org. Brought to you by End Family Fire, Brady, and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Shirley Stabe from Kingston, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
You're listening to WGHQ, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, the home of Kingston Community Radio, and streaming online at mykcr.org. My name is Dan Gatiss, and it is 8:02 a.m., 66 degrees on this Tuesday, August 31st, last day of the month. This morning program is brought to you by Robert Baum Commercial Realty, located at 79 St. James Street, Kingston, New York. Visit rgbaum.com, rgbaum.com for more information. A little bit about our weather for today. Partly cloudy skies this morning will become overcast more during the afternoon with a high of 82. And partly cloudy skies early tonight will give way to cloudy skies later. And a low of 61. Rain showers in the morning, on Wednesday morning, will evolve into a more steady rain in the afternoon. Potential for flooding rains, a high of 68, 90% chance of rain. And same Wednesday night, cloudy with periods of rain, 100% chance of rain all Wednesday night. Winds, no significance, the wind. And chance of rain is 100%. And again, the low is 57. Let's get back to the on-air studio with Nina Postupack and Cameron Rylance. And it looks like we have some good birthdays today.
do.
Yeah, four birthdays. So
we're excited about that, right, Cameron?
So let's get right into it. Today, August 31st. Nina, why don't you go?
So I have. I'm looking at this because it says Saturday, August 31st, but it should be Tuesday, August 31st. A very happy birthday to Tony Costa from the Cruz family and friends. So happy birthday, Tony.
All right. I have happy birthday to Bill Murphy from your family and friends.
And then please wish a happy birthday to Helen Shabbat from your friends at the Friendship Bible Coffee.
And I believe it's the last one, to Jason Riley from your friends at the People's Place, and they hope you enjoy your special day. So let's put these all together, put them in the randomizer. Congratulations to Jason Riley. You are the winner of a Boyce Brothers Dairy cow pie.
All right, so that's great, Jason.
Go see the fine folks at Boyce Brothers Dairy at 62 O'Neill Street. Tell them that you are today's birthday winner and claim your pie and share it with all your friends and loved ones. So congratulations, Jason. So listeners, see that? Four birthdays today. So that's awesome.
It is awesome.
Send them on in.
Coincidentally, yesterday there were none.
Oh, they all came in. That's great.
Yay. Well, they're all for today.
There you go. So
there were many for tomorrow.
Send them in, people. Mail, email. Snail mail.
Yeah, email is kcr921@gmail.com, and that's a good way to get them in. Or, of course, you can mail them to Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York, 12402. Get them in. That's organizations, sick. Clubs, classes, whoever.
There you go. So this is a call-in show, right? 331-9255, and Nina and I have successfully wasted an hour and 5 minutes.
Yes, but we would love to hear from you.
Regale you with tales of adventure.
Yes.
Shenanigans. But call 331-9255. Ask us a question. Stump us with trivia. I don't know.
Right.
Tell us a joke. I've never been a good joke rememberer.
No, I'm not a good joke teller.
It's.
And you have to have a way of delivering that punchline. Oh, you can tell a good joke.
I can remember them or whatever, but I just can't.
They go right out of your head as quick as you hear them.
The only ones I remember are the dirtiest jokes.
Yeah.
The ones you can't tell on the air.
Can't say that on terrestrial radio.
Yeah, right?
5 a.m.
So I thought maybe, Cameron, we could talk a little bit about, we get a lot of phone calls at the office in regard to what are the policies at the county office building. So those of you that are listening, if you come to the county office building, we have now, you cannot come in the back door of the county office building anymore because we have employee-only entrance there, and that's for safety reasons. It's very difficult for the security guards to watch both doors.
Yeah.
So this way they watch the front doors for the public entering and the back doors for employees only. Of course, if you are handicapped, or wheelchair bound or anything of that nature, that you can call and the number's posted right there as security and they will come out and open the door for you so you don't have to go all the way around the building. You must have your vaccination card if you're vaccinated to not have to wear the mask. If you do not have your card, even if you're vaccinated, you must wear a mask when you come into the building.
Accept the Excelsior Pass?
Yes, and they will accept the Excelsior Pass, yes. And, of course, we have somebody at the door who's doing contact tracing as well as taking your temperature, and the temperature is mounted the thermometer is mounted on the wall, so it's a self temperature procedure. So as you enter the county building, be prepared for that, and whether you agree with it or you do not agree with it, the people that are at the door and the people that are there, the employees that are monitoring you as you enter the building, they're only following the rules and regulations. So please realize that when you come into the building. If you're coming to the DMV, you do need an appointment. We do have same day appointments though right now. So you're able to go to the information booth. If you don't have a computer at home, you can go to information. They will book you an appointment. If you want, you can call 340-3040 and we'll make an appointment for you. Otherwise, the rest of the building is open. We try to monitor in the county clerk's office at the recording counter, two customers at a time, and there's waiting area, plenty of space, and social distancing out in the hallway so that we can be as safe as possible for not only the customers, but for the employees also.
You got to work.
And then, as we mentioned before, employees that are working for the county must either be vaccinated or are tested weekly by the health department. Those that are unvaccinated, and that's the county does that. It's on county time, and county pays for it. But again, not only for the safety of the office, but also for the safety of people entering the building also. So, and I know the county exec has been coming a little more concerned because of the rise in the COVID cases. So we're trying to stay as safe as possible in the office. But if you have any questions in regard to procedures for the county building, procedures for DMV, of course you can call in on the show, 331-9255, but you can also call the office at 340-3040 or 340-3700. And we'll be more than happy to answer any of your questions. Yeah. About that or any other issues that you may have.
Yeah, I've seen a lot more people wearing masks.
Again. I have too. I was at Hannaford over the weekend. People have masks on. Everywhere you go, I've noticed more masks. Stores.
Have you, being a nice Italian girl,
yes.
Have you ever been to Uncle Giuseppe's in New Jersey?
No, I have not.
Oh, well, I heard about it a while ago. Oh, it's a huge Italian market and they got a great selection
of
food.
I've heard of it.
You've been to Rossi's in Poughkeepsie?
Yes.
You know how they have that deli cabinet with like the prosciutto? Imagine that literally 20 times longer. Like this deli cabinet, they had like three kinds of rice balls.
Mm.
Stuffed, plain, prosciutto.
Did you stop on your way?
On the way back.
Okay.
Because I said, we're on Friday coming back from the Saturday morning, coming back from the Jersey. And it was perfect time. It's like 11:30. It's lunchtime. So we go in. And it's as big as Hannaford. But it's – and they have full groceries and everything. But, you know, a lot of it's, you know, Italian stuff. And, bakery. I walked by because I had to use the men's room. And had to walk by the bakery. Crazy, like dicings. You know, the same amount
size.
Of array and you know, the cabinets and, like, the bustle. It was like, oh, my goodness. The deli counter, you know, unbelievable. The meat, fresh meat, you know, crazy. But the food, prepared food, you know, chicken meatballs, regular meatballs, you know, three kinds of rice balls, the cutlets, eggplant.
Amazing, right?
You know,
and there was enough traffic to ensure that all of that stuff was going to go within a day
or two, right?
Honestly, it was like standing in an episode of Sopranos.
Yeah.
A lot of Northern Jersey Italian folks, you know, women with, you know, perfectly made, you know, whatever. Cars full of stuff. But, you know, like, you know, the squid salad, the octopus salad, the seafood, it was unbelievable. It was awesome. But, like, you know, we got some sandwiches, like, you know, eggplant parm with fire roasted red peppers, fresh mozzarella, and prosciutto.
Oh my gosh!
Like on the good seated
Italian bread,
bastone, you know, Italian bread. Oh my god, so good!
Oh my god, my mouth is watering. Right, he's making me hungry.
You gotta go. Anyone that's within the sound of my voice, if you like Italian food, go to Uncle
Giuseppe.
Tell
us where it's located.
It's on the northbound side of 17, roughly around where Cantmore is.
Okay.
Middle of Route 17, you know, right in the, I forget what township it's in. But I noticed the fireplace, or the fireside, the diner that's on the northbound side, it's been there forever. The fireside inn or the fireplace, it's like a diner. It's closed. It's empty. It was,
really?
And that was like a landmark. When you saw that place, okay, I know exactly how far I am from home.
Right.
It was just because it's always been there. It's never changed. It's the same, but it was...
Must be because of the pandemic, maybe. Yeah.
I don't know. It looked empty. It looked like it was closed. Like they had emptied out the stuff.
Yeah, maybe.
But, Yeah, Uncle Giuseppe's.
Uncle Giuseppe's.
Like, it's worth the trip. It was like unbelievable.
We have to remember that the next time. Yeah. And everybody that's listening, when next time you're down in Jersey and on 17.
If you're driving north, stop
in. What's the distance from Uncle Giuseppe's to home?
Oh, 80 miles. Whatever.
Okay.
Yeah, it's close. It's right in the middle of 17.
It's
before Patterson Plank, you know, the Giants, anybody goes to Giants games. Before, you know, on the northbound side, it's, you know, after Patterson Plank, it's before. It's right near, before you get those Italian, like, tile places.
Yes.
Like the design center with all the, you know,
yes.
$15,000 couches there.
Yeah.
It's right before that. But,
okay.
Yeah, can't recommend it enough. So
all
good.
All right.
So good.
So the next person that goes, call in and let us know what your experience was at Uncle Giuseppe's.
And I didn't really look at the groceries or anything. I'm sure it was premium price. One, you're in, like, you know, one of the more affluent areas of the country.
Right.
I didn't see if the eggs were, like, ridiculously expensive or whatever, because we were there for, like, the food, you know,
the Italian
specialties and the deli and everything. But, you know, Parma ham's hanging up, you know, if it's $12 a pound, that thing must weigh 15 pounds. You know, it's like an $80 hunk of meat hanging there or whatever. And there's 10 of them and the cheeses, and it was cool. It was really neat. Great shopping experience, whatever.
That's great. So
it's just a great dining experience.
So you made me think of something when you were talking about where it's located. Next week starts football season, right?
That's right.
You mentioned the Giants, so it made me think of that. And we always know that the fall is here when that first Sunday and you put the TV on and the football season starts, right?
I'm not sure how I feel about the Giants. I'm optimistic, but, you know, had a close game, quote unquote, against New England the other day.
Yes,
but,
they
you know,
did.
That, you know, the starters came out and whatever.
It's hard preseason.
Yeah.
Can't tell too much there.
But our defense looks good.
Yes, it'll be. Hopefully, it'll be a good year. Let's wait and see.
I've been a Daniel Jones fan, and I'm. He's got this year. If he doesn't
prove
himself this year, then I'm not going to be a fan anymore.
I think most people feel that way.
Yep.
This is the year for him. Yep. Yeah, and I think now tell me, Eli and Peyton are doing some commentary.
Yeah, they're
Eli Manning and Peyton
they're,
Manning.
Two Monday night games.
Yes,
they're scheduled to be the.
I think that's great.
Yeah,
brothers
awesome.
And you have
actually, Lawrence has heard it because he's told me that they're fantastic. They did like some demos, like
for the
ESPN, like to test them out or something. And
one,
they're brothers, so they have this camaraderie that, you know.
Absolutely.
And, apparently Eli is always kind of stiff, you know, in conferences and or you know post game interviews and stuff. But I guess when he's like. Off the field, he's like a jokester. Like, you know,
tie
your shoelaces together when you fall asleep on the couch or whatever. Like, he's a practical joker and, like, you know, super fun guy. So
it'll be interesting to see him in a different light.
Peyton has an awesome personality.
Which
come out some of the commercials he's done.
Yes,
and,
yes.
I've seen him on, like, you know, the Ellen DeGeneres or Saturday Night Live. You know, he's been some.
Yeah, he's done a few.
And he's great. He's funny. You know, he's not afraid to make fun of himself. And
no, he's good.
Yeah, so
very
it should
good.
Be interesting.
Yeah, and the U.S. Open.
Yeah.
So we're big tennis fans, obviously, in our household. And
down at all? Do you think?
Well, I don't think so. We've been down, you know, in the past, and it's a great day, and we're so lucky. We're so close to it. We've enjoyed it, and it's funny because Serena isn't playing, Venus isn't playing, Rafael Nadal isn't playing, and Federer isn't playing. And they said since 1997, this is the first time that one or all have not been at the U.S. Open, so almost 25 years, and I think that's really. The time frame that I've been following tennis and so forth. So it's the first year that none of them involved. But Djokovic is going for the Grand Slam.
Yeah, I'm saying there's.
So he might be making some.
Some of the young women are phenomenal.
Yeah, Osaka won last night. Yeah. Watched
Sloan
her.
Sloan is good.
Sloan Stevens, yes. And she played Madison Keys in the first round. So two Americans playing. Yeah, won another first round, which was too bad. And they said that Rod Laver will be there at the end.
Really?
Because, right, he's the last man to have won a Grand Slam. Yeah. And if Djokovic does accomplish
that's cool. Imagine
Rod Laver will be there.
He'll be, you know, Rod Laver handing you the
Oh my gosh.
Trophy or whatever, right? Being on the stage, that's cool.
Yeah.
Those were like my favorite sneakers growing up.
Oh, they tore. I read
Adidas.
Yes, I read an article about that.
They'd be foolish not to bring them back. At least some limited edition.
They told the story where Rod Laver was at the U.S. Open, and he had those sneakers on, and someone said, "Oh, I love those sneakers. I wish we could get those sneakers." And they're like, "Oh my God, you're Rod Laver. Those are Rod Laver sneakers." Yeah. So you're that's right. Funny. You're right. Absolutely.
They're my favorite sneakers.
So, yeah, it's fun to watch. And, of course, with all the other ones.
Yalom's, right?
Yeah, right.
Down below.
Yalom's. Yeah, I used to walk down. And it's nice because all the other majors are time differences. You know, the Australian Open and French Open, Wimbledon. Yeah, so it's nice to be able to watch in our time zone and not have the matches already happen and be watching them in retrospect. Yeah. So, which is great. And the Yankees are doing great.
They're doing well.
Right.
Playing good. They're still four games behind Tampa Bay.
But they went 13 games in a row, right?
Italian Stallions.
Yeah, they brought in Rizzo there.
Rizzo and Joey Gallo.
Yeah. Yeah. So first time they did that since 1987, I believe.
Stats in the freaking paper.
I know they don't, though.
There's articles about, like, the Bengals.
Yeah, but
there's no American League stats.
I know. And the Mets, how about a little controversy there with some of the players? Did you see they did the thumbs down?
What's
this? Yeah, some of the Mets players, did you see that? They did a thumbs down and to the fans because they won, and the fans have been, like, booing them and they've been really giving them a hard time. So now they won two nights ago. So they went to the fans, like, thumbs down to you guys. Now we won. So it started a little bit of a controversy, and the owner's not too happy and so forth. But, you know, we're all human athletes. Fans, we all react to the
New York fans turn on a dime.
They do.
You're winning on Sunday, you know,
you're the best thing there ever was.
Oh, the guy's a bum. Get rid of him. You know, every Mets, Rangers, Knicks, whatever, every team. You know, New York fans are either the most
brutal,
they're the most passionate, or they're the worst.
Yeah, absolutely.
They
felt bad for the Mets. They were doing so well, and then to have that losing streak
a couple injuries.
Yeah, it was difficult. Yeah,
DeGrom is out.
Right.
He's the best pitcher in the National League.
So, anyway, that was a little bit of a controversy.
Yeah, that's why I hadn't heard that. Yeah.
So, right now, active time in sports between baseball, football, tennis.
Yeah.
A lot going on.
And, of course, they're retiring, I think, is it the first game of the year? They're retiring Eli's number and putting his name up on the Ring of Honor. Giant Stadium,
I bet it is. Is it first game home?
Yeah. The Broncos, yeah. Well, I don't know if it's their first game, but the first home game they're doing it.
Right, okay.
I don't know if they open home or on the road. I don't know. I honestly don't know. Lawrence, if you're listening, maybe you could correct that.
Or yes, let us know.
Straight. But other than that, so here's a call-in show, people, 331-9255, and hopefully Lindsey Timbrook will be joining us at 8:30.
Yes, and we hear what's happening in the Parks and Recs.
This is tough. This fifth Tuesday completely snuck up on me.
It did, on both of us,
We thought about it a couple weeks ago, and then whatever, and then, oops, here we are.
Yeah, but that's okay. It worked out well, and we're happy to have Lindsey at 8:30, which will be great. And Parks and Recs is, that department is busy. Spring, fall, winter, summer, there's always activities going on. So we're looking forward to hearing from her, that's for sure. And I have to tell you, I was going down Broadway the other day, and the whole configuration where Planet Wings,
I haven't been there yet.
It's really coming together.
It's a new traffic
pattern,
right? Traffic pattern there. It's all been taken up by a new traffic pattern, which is stellar.
Awesome.
Yes, I agree. Looks great. Paving it's not done
Broadway.
Yet, but
I came off the traffic circle yesterday coming home from work. I was like, oh shoot, I gotta get gas. So went down Broadway to Perry's. Perry's. And it was paved. It was like, you know, I was like, oh my goodness, thank God they started
finally
paving.
Right. Yeah, I'm happy for the business owners, restaurants, everything along that whole Broadway corridor.
It looks like an incredible resurgence.
as we move into the fall. I think they're going to have an incredible business quarter during the fall.
I hope so.
Because it's just really, really coming into shape. And it's really, really, you know, all the way from People's Place at the turnaround up through past the new traffic pattern there by the old post office.
Yeah.
All the way down to the Rondout. That whole corridor is, I think, just going to be an incredible boon for those businesses.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of new ones along Broadway.
And if you haven't, any new businesses that are opening up along Broadway are going to really enjoy that boom.
You know,
that,
it's hard because
they're going to get it, and I think it'll stay.
Yes, I do too. And it's hard because everything was done at once. But I think at the end of the day, it's great because the finished product comes all together.
It'll be integral. Yes. It'll be integral, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Did you see a couple of articles in the paper today?
I read the paper today.
Woman had an 80-pound cougar
in her New York City apartment
as a pet.
Yes,
Did you see an 80-pound dog? Like, that's as big as a German shepherd.
And it was only like 8 months old or something, right?
8 months old.
Yeah.
What's going to happen in like a year and a half from now? Like this, how much is it going to eat? Where do you get, buying chicken and steaks every day? What the heck are you doing?
Well, it's not fair to the animal.
No, it's not fair to the animal. I mean, it needs to be in its habitat.
Yeah.
Right. They did move it to the Bronx Zoo, and then they're putting it in a wild,
Arkansas, yeah. Yes. Which sounds much better place for a cougar than a Manhattan apartment, or not Manhattan, where?
Yeah, it was Manhattan, Upper East Side.
Yes. Oh, God. Cougar.
Crazy.
But I've seen documentaries and stuff that there are like more illegal captive tigers than this is a guesstimate, like National Geographic wildlife tracking, like more illegal tigers in America as there are in the wild in the world. And then like Arab
statistic
and emirs and Chinese businessmen and South America, like there's like way more lions and tigers than like private care than in the wild, which is baffling to me. But what, like Mike Tyson supposedly had a tiger. Like, what, how can you get enjoy? It's not like it's not gonna like come and sit on your lap, or it's not affectionate. They're wild animals.
I would be concerned. You. Yeah, I was just gonna say that. I would be concerned. That they could do harm. Yeah, absolutely. And like you said, they're wild animals.
Yeah, and it's like same as people keep poisonous snakes. You know, it's like, you know, I guess
that's the panache. That's the panache. You're playing with fate.
Yeah, I mean, I had fish tanks for 40 years, and I've had piranhas over the years. You know, but they're like this big. They're in a tank. It's not like it's gonna hurt you, whatever. And funny story. Remember those snakeheads? They're an invasive species. It was a long fish. They get huge. It was like a very long fish, and they're aggressive and wild. I had one. It was in a 55-gallon aquarium. It's probably like a 12-foot long fish. And this thing, when it would get, and you had to feed it. Feeder, goldfish, and when it would get hungry, it would get aggressive. Like it would watch you, and it would peck the fence, peck the glass. Like this thing was conscious of what was going on, and when it would get hungry, it would let you know. It would splash. It would hit the top of the tank. So one day, this is when I owned the West Strand Grill. I had a female roommate at the time, friend, you know, whatever. It had jumped, and these things can live on land. They go from mud pond to mud pond, whatever. This thing had jumped out of the tank, and it freaked her out.
Oh, well, I don't blame her. It would freak me out.
She's she screamed. She didn't know what to do, so she got like my big stock pot, my big spaghetti pot, and put it over it and like, piled up a bunch of books on top. And
I think almost any female would do that.
Yeah, left it. You know,
damn it, you stupid fish.
I would probably have to run out of the apartment myself.
Yeah, she was freaked because she knew it was a great, she has seen it eat and, whatever.
Where do you buy something like that?
For a while, they were in. Pet store, I think I got it at PetSmart or something.
Buy
them.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
But they turned out to be an invasive species, whatever. But if they're released into the wild, like in down south, they can live. And, like many invasive species are inadvertently introduced, like pythons. And they're, like, eating everything in the Everglades. Like, escape I could talk 20 minutes about this. Escaped snakes in the Everglades are literally eating they're eating cougar cubs, like Florida panthers. It's literally, eventually, alligators. There's going to be alligators and snakes. No, they're eating like the raccoons.
Yeah,
the birds.
You know what? You are.
It's unbelievable.
Right. And you are introducing probably a whole new realm of biodiversity and biological.
They're killing biodiversity.
And biological consciousness, because we've already experienced that with COVID. Our relationship to nature needs to be looked at very carefully.
Yeah, it's
very carefully.
Crazy.
You know, when we go from lake to lake, even with our boats, we have to be conscious of this.
Absolutely. Yeah, you got
to. You know, we have to be conscious of these kinds of
zebra mussels
and intermixings. Yeah. I mean, I've got Chinese hops all over my yard that I can't get, you know, that are they just take over the garden, they take over things, and they're invasive. They're not an indigenous plant.
Yeah. Well, look at the tree
everywhere.
The ash borer, you know, it's killing all the ash trees.
Yeah, I think a raising of awareness, for the original indigenous biodiversity, as opposed to these invasive practices. They're not practices, they're mistakes usually, but they're happening. And I think that along with climate change, it's very, very important to look at that.
Absolutely.
You're very, very correct about that. Yeah, and we could talk about this for 20 minutes.
Oh, absolutely.
We got to go to break.
Yeah, we got to go to break. So. All right.
Okay, and thank you for being with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, WGHQ. And it's the bottom of the hour, 8:30, and it's Tuesday, August 31st, 66 degrees here in uptown Kingston. And this last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Robert Baum. This morning program brought to you by Robert Baum Commercial Realty, located at 79 St. James Street, Kingston, New York. Visit rgbaum.com for more information. We'll be right back after these messages.
Thanks for starting your day with Kingston Community Radio on 920 WGHQ AM Kingston and 92.5 W223 CR FM Kingston, New York. Magic 92.5.
Hi, this is Tony Marmo from Norman Staffing, and we've been bringing together employers and job seekers since 1980. If you're an employer and have job vacancies, let Norman Staffing help fill them with permanent or temporary workers. We screen, interview, and recommend the best candidates for your company. We make the employment process easier and faster for you. Please call Norman Staffing for your employment needs at 338-9111, 338-9111, or normanstaffing.com.
Okay, forest animals, kids are coming to the forest, and it's up to us to make their visit a good one. Sparrow, have you practiced the most popular bird songs for the year?
Of course.
Catchy. I like it. River, how's the temperature?
It's a refreshing 52 degrees, man.
I love it. Turtle.
He's not here yet, man.
He's late every morning. Okay, squirrel.
The forest has been preparing just for you. To learn more about cool things to do in the forest, visit discovertheforest.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Scott Harrington from Hurley, and I support Kingston Community Radio because the people need a place to have their voice heard, and it's lost in corporate radio, so please keep listening and supporting our station.
Hey, you're here with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. This upcoming portion of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Rondout Savings Bank, a powerful community bank that has leaders that are involved in their community. Rondout Savings, always working for you and our community with branches in Kingston, West Hurley, and Hyde Park, also online at rondoutbank.com. Equal housing lender, member FDIC. And Mid-Hudson Valley weather and forecast one more time before we sign off. Partly cloudy skies this morning, become overcast during the afternoon, a high of 82 today.
Tonight, partly cloudy skies early will give way to cloudy skies later in the night. A low of 61, and that is for tonight. And Wednesday, rain showers in the morning, evolving into more steady rain in the afternoon. Potential for flooding rains, a high of 68. That's a 90% chance of rain during the day on Wednesday. And Wednesday night, cloudy with continued periods of rain. Potential for flooding and a low of 57. Thursday, rain is ending early as the day breaks. And breaks of sun in the afternoon. We'll have some sun Thursday and a high of 72. And Thursday night, we go down to 54 with a clear skies. Let's get back to the on-air studio with Nina Postupack and Cameron Rylance and our new guest.
We are back.
We are, and it's the last half hour, yeah, and, right?
Nina, you were lucky enough to book our guest, so why don't
you... Yes, and we're so excited to have her. So we have Lindsey Timbrook here, who's the director of the Parks and Recreation for the city of Kingston, and we're just talking off the air about the successful season you had this summer, and coming into the fall, all the activities and programs that will be available. So congratulations on putting together a great camp and summer program. Yeah. Coming off of the pandemic, and I know the kids were ready to get out there and do their thing, so congratulations. Let's talk a little bit about what you did this summer and the camps and the programs and so forth.
Thank you, and thank you for having me. So this year it really it was refreshing to be able to offer our programs again. Last year was it was really unfortunate not to be able to offer our usual lineup, but we did have a very successful season for summer camp. It was filled to capacity. Our tennis clinics did very well. Junior Naturalist was very popular this year.
What is that, Lindsey?
Yeah, so our Junior Naturalist program allows the kids in the community to really just kind of get familiar with, you know, environmental education, the animals at the Nature Center. Casey is our rec leader that heads that program. She takes them on field trips to Minnewaska. They go to the Point.
Great.
Yeah, we did a day that we brought a couple of our rec commissioners, and they were really impressed with the kind of activities they get to do. They do some archery, fishing, kayaking. They really, it's a wonderful program to offer, and a lot of people don't really know about it.
Is that new? Is that something that, or have you had that for a while?
We've had it for quite a bit. Okay. I think word is starting to get out there and it's catching on a little bit.
I didn't know about that.
And it's only, it's typically a week-long program. So if a kid is signed up for summer camp, they can still participate in that for the week. So, and then go back to their usual camp.
How many different sessions of that do you run?
I believe there's four,
broken up by age group. 4 weeks of that program.
Yes.
Oh, that's cool.
Yep, and I think the final week is actually 2 weeks. Because that's the older groups.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you know, I'm not putting it on the spot, do you know how many kids you served this summer?
Not total, but for summer camp, we did have 50 at each location. We were talking earlier about, because of the pandemic, we had to cap off our attendance.
So a couple hundred kids, though.
200 for the four parks. I'd have to run the numbers for the tennis clinics and the junior naturalist program. But
so several hundred kids were served. That's great.
Yeah, absolutely. And hopefully next year we don't have to limit capacity so much, and we can continue to increase those numbers.
Now, kayaking, the city has a little fleet, your own little kayak navy, don't they?
We do run a kayaking program. Casey, same individual that does Junior Naturalist. She's a wonderful rec leader who hosts a lot of different kayak sessions. There are various days of the week, depending on what day or time you go. Sometimes you see different types of wildlife. It just is a different experience for each session that you do. So that has picked up as well, especially during the pandemic when, there wasn't a lot that we could do. So we noticed an increase in that program specifically.
Also, you have some nice changes coming up. But the Barman Park is a new addition. And what's happening down at the Point is going to be awesome.
The Point is going to be great. Not only are we adding a new parking lot in the front area there, putting in a new playground, and we are adding, for the first time, a youth soccer field. So that is going to be...
That'll be the first one in the city of Kingston, right? All the other soccer fields are in town of Ulster and outlying areas.
Yeah, right. Now, are you eventually, will you be having a league, like a Kingston Junior Soccer League?
We would hope to be able to do so. Currently, though, there seems to be a large following of these kind of clubs that exist. Travel, yeah. Yeah, travel clubs.
And KASL is big. But yes. I'm sure you're going to want to use your field.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Just getting... Either way, but yeah. We're going to have kids on playing soccer down
absolutely.
There.
Absolutely.
Okay, and we don't want to mow an empty field. No, we mow a soccer pitch.
There is a lot of interest in that field, and awesome. We already have teams lined up to reserve it. Unfortunately, it's not ready to be used, but we are looking forward to that for the spring.
Great.
Yeah.
Fantastic. So, and we were talking about pickleball, right, up there also.
Yes.
And that is a huge following for pickleball.
Growing every day. Yes. Absolutely. And as I mentioned, my father's down at Laurent Park often, and they have quite a following for pickleball.
Are there any organized city leagues, or is it all pickup?
It's kind of pickup. It's intramurals. There's a kind of a group that's already formed down there for adults anyways, but they've generously offered to have kids come by. And if they want to learn how to play, they're willing to show them and teach them. And so we've offered that for our summer camp kids, especially at Lauren Park.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Now, if it keeps growing, would you look into like having a city rec league?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. If the interest is there, we will definitely do it. Absolutely.
You got volleyball, softball, I guess that's it, right? Volleyball, softball.
Basketball.
Oh, basketball. Yep. Yeah.
Basketball. So, yeah. Yeah. We definitely want to expand, the kinds of programs that we offer. For example, with basketball, we have our over 30 adult league. But something new that we're doing this year, we want to offer an over 50 kind of pickup league.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
Yeah, because I'm at like Wayne.
Yes,
I know.
I'm eligible for that.
Well, yes. And that's the thing is like, there's some players that kind of just want to do a casual pickup game the way you would see at the Y.
There's a big difference between a 35-year-old athlete and a 55-year-old.
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Absolutely. Yeah, and so like guys like my dad, and Dwayne even, I know that they can hang with the younger guys, but I think sometimes they just prefer to go and have a casual game just for fun and no refs, no sign-ups and rosters. So we will be dealing with the age though very very strictly. I do not want it to turn into another version of over 30. So, but it is going to be.
I think that's a great idea.
Yeah,
yeah,
so
that's fantastic.
We're looking to start that.
Try.
Yeah, See. And it's kind of a pilot program. We're just going to do it as intramural type thing during the day. September 8th will be the first day. We're looking to start somewhere around 12:30 to 2:30. And it's just drop-in. There will be a sign-in sheet. And again, you have to add your birth date. But it's going to be pretty casual.
That's great. So that's one new program that's coming this fall.
Absolutely. And a lot of our usual programs are returning, hoping that nothing gets shut down again. But indoor volleyball, we will also be starting up our general over 30 league.
Did you do beach volleyball this summer?
We did.
Okay.
Yeah,
good.
We did. Great. Yep. We had a lot of teams returning, a lot of new players. That is actually still going on. That should be ending the end of September. And so will our softball league. Yeah.
So now, Lindsey, we're talking about
those are always.
Oh yeah, 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 yeah.
Softball is like
it's a way of life.
The softball players couldn't wait to get started again.
Absolutely.
That was probably devastating last year.
Oh my gosh.
Like every night of the week.
Yeah,
it's upper A, D, B, women, men's.
Yes,
all over the place.
It was very upsetting to have to shut down all these programs. People want stuff to do, after work and.
Now, are you responsible for the pool as well?
The pool, the beach, yes. Yes, that was a
purview.
Yes, and so the pool. We had a great season at the pool. The mayor was generous and wanted to give a gift to the city this year and not charge for the pool. He recognized that everyone had a tough year, and so it was free of charge for anyone. You still had to register.
Was it busy?
It was very busy.
Normal?
Yep, it was very busy, and we had
more so than normal. You think?
Yes, because as you might have noticed, the beach unfortunately had to close a couple of times. Mm-hmm. Per the health department, and on top of that, there was a shortage of lifeguards, which we are noticing with the pandemic. Businesses are struggling to fill, service positions. We're seeing it all across the county, with lifeguards.
Absolutely.
So that was really tough because people look forward to going to the beach.
Yes.
It's a natural space that folks want to enjoy. And so at times we had to make a decision, you know, which do we keep open, which do we close? And the pool definitely was a priority at that point.
Yeah. And you did renovations there. You had the splash pad. Which is great.
Every time I drove by during the day, there's people.
Yeah.
I saw a person in a walker.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, a senior person.
Right. Absolutely.
You know.
Yeah, it's a really cool space. You know, it did have some adjustments with the filter. It's all very new for us, but we were able to get it up and running, and folks got to enjoy it. We got a lot of great feedback about it. So we're hoping to be able to get that open sooner next year.
That's great.
Yeah.
So we talk about all these programs and everything, Lindsey. If people want to get involved, if people want to join the volleyball league or everything.
Yeah.
How did they do it?
Yeah, they could call our office at 481-7330 and just ask about what we have going on. We have our Facebook page that we try to update as much as possible. We recently restarted an Instagram page. I don't know if you guys are up on Instagram, but you know, we just want to reach as many people as possible. And then, of course, our sign-up page is kingstonparksandrec.org.
And so you can go online right to the website and sign up.
Absolutely, also. And additional websites on the Kingston Cities page as well, kingston-ny.gov.
Yeah. And now the Bitty League is under your jurisdiction also, right?
Bitty League, that's my, you know, that's my favorite.
Yeah, I know, me too, I know.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes, it's our youth Bitty League, and we offer various divisions. And again, it wasn't able to occur last year, but that is probably our most popular.
Where does that run?
That's right out of the Midtown Center. Midtown? Yeah.
Okay.
Our 7-year-old group happens out of the Roundout Center on Friday nights.
Okay.
So,
I was going to say, because that's,
whatever,
you know, you got two indoor courts.
Yes,
so.
Absolutely. The Midtown Center is the, I would say, the the premier court.
One court or two courts in Midtown?
One. One court. I mean, if you put the portable hoops in and split the court up, you could, but the one legal,
full size court.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what are the age groups for the Bitty League?
So for Bitty, we have as young as 7, and then we have a girls group. The whole program is co-ed, I just want to say that, but we do offer a all-girls league if that's preferable. That's 8 to 12. Then we have an 8 to 10 group, and 11 to 13, and then 14 to 17, which usually starts in January.
So that's busy.
The
Midtown Center is busy.
Very busy. Absolutely.
And that starts like October, November?
October is usually when sign-ups start, but the program practices start November, and then December is usually the first round of games.
So that's great. That's great for the kids. Opportunity.
Absolutely.
So it's good that it's starting up again this year.
Absolutely. Really excited about it.
Yeah, that's for sure. Yeah. So let me ask you one other thing. If people, like I know Bitty League, people want to sponsor teams and things, maybe you could talk a little bit about that because it's a great opportunity to sponsor a team
absolutely.
And get the youth out there.
Yeah, absolutely. So we do offer a sponsorship program. If any business or group would like to sponsor a team, we do offer that. If you want to reach out to me directly at the office, that'd be great. I'd be happy to speak about that. But it does give folks the opportunity to give back to the community, allows a space for another team to sign up, and as well as coaches. We could always use coaches. So if you're looking to coach, we have a space for you. But I believe Dwayne used to coach, right?
Yeah, so
I think he might have been my coach 1 year.
And he sponsors a team.
Absolutely.
Now, how much is
Postupack valuation? That's right. Yes. Little shout out there. Yes.
So what is the cost to sponsor?
I believe I'd have to verify that, but I believe it is
ballpark
$5.55 maybe. Yes.
Okay. And that's t-shirts with the name on the back.
With your business name.
Your business.
Yep. And at the end of the year when we do our Bitty League banquet, we include every business on our brochure and our pamphlets. Whenever we also try to include the score sheets in the Freeman every week, we submit those, and so that includes the team name, and kids love seeing their names in the paper, and how many points they drop that week. So that's definitely just like a fun, exciting thing we try
to do.
It's
a competitive week.
Oh yeah,
yeah. I mean,
very.
You playoffs and
absolutely.
Championships and everything.
Yeah.
So it's great for the kids.
Absolutely, absolutely, and it's fun for them to play with their friends, especially kids that maybe don't make it on the high school team or the modified teams and stuff. It just gives them another space to be able to play.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah. Absolutely. So, yeah, very much looking forward to that. We also have flag football starting up. That's a
Oh, really? Yes, in the fall. I've seen it at Black Park.
We try to host as many games as possible at Dietz. It is a little challenging with once the school starts up with their sports.
Last year
we had to cap that as well. So this year we're definitely looking forward to inviting the kids back, and we are offering a new division for that. That we are offering the 14 to 16 age range.
Oh.
So again, for kids who maybe don't want to go out for the football team or didn't, you know, unfortunately make it, we would still want to give them the opportunity to play and just have fun. Yeah.
And what's the other age group?
The other age group we have are 8 to 10 and 11 to 13. Yeah.
That's great. And that season runs right from September to like November,
yeah.
right?
Usually early November if there's rain dates. Yeah. yeah. Oh, yes, definitely. So that's fun. The kids get to play under the lights and it's a, you know.
On the turf?
Yeah, absolutely. Cool. And, you know, it's not tackle. We try to make sure the kids understand that. Sometimes that's always the challenge.
The whole concept, yes. The flag.
He's trying his flag.
Yes. Oh, my goodness. You should see it. It is really fun to watch, though. It is really fun. And that also is co-ed. So we definitely want to get the word out. Love to get some girls interested in playing.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I was talking to Nadine Ferrero the other day, and she mentioned how her daughter used to play, and I would love to make sure that, you know, we open it up to as many participants as possible.
Perfect co-ed.
Yeah.
It's non-contact, so everyone, you know, and chances are, you know.
Yeah. Listen, the girls will run out there.
That little girl could be the star of the team.
That's right.
So,
that's right. You better watch out for them.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I remember hearing that there's going to be some, I guess, improvements or modifications to, like, way Forsyth Park and the stadium are connected, or
yes,
parking.
Yeah,
can you maybe explain that.
I can say a little bit, because today there's actually going to be an announcement made by Mayor Noble over at Dietz Stadium, and so that will be celebrating the 100th anniversary for Dietz. So that will be at 2:00. That is open for all. Anyone who would like to join, he will be discussing the possible renovations and. Looking forward to another 100 years. That's the slogan is, you know, celebrating 100 and going for another 100. Yeah.
That's a great venue there, you know, with the park, and you forget about it sometimes.
Yes.
Like you concentrate on the stadium itself, but you forget about the whole, you know, park being there.
Yeah.
And you have the tennis courts, which we talked about, that have been completely renovated.
Yep.
You have the animals there.
Oh, the Forsyth Nature Center, yeah.
And there's quite a bit to do. And then you have the picnic area, the pavilion.
Yeah. Forsyth
so
is
you
very
could tie
busy.
It all in together, you could see more utilization of that whole area.
The whole space, and especially like we were saying with the pool and the splash pad.
Yeah,
it's just
pool too, right?
Yeah, it's really just enhancing one of our most popular amenities and just making it a tourism site in itself. You'd be surprised how many people from out of town come just for that location. And so with high school sports and Stockade Football Club, Dietz Stadium is being used now more than ever. So we definitely have to make these renovations want to make sure that we can keep it going and for the next generation of kids and athletes. Yeah.
Which is great. So you have a busy fall.
Yes, we do.
Right?
Very busy.
Yeah, coming off of a summer with the camps and everything else.
Yeah.
And then when we get into the winter season, the basketball continues.
Yep.
And do you have any and volleyball goes into winter?
Yes, volleyball and basketball go well into winter. And we also have some, you know, our other programs that we offer, our senior programs.
Let's talk about that a little bit. Yes.
Yeah, our home crafters. They actually have returned to the building, which is really exciting. That's a safe place for them to come and to interact and just have a couple hours to work on some different crafting projects. So they are back in the building. We are also expecting to have our ceramics group return. So that's exciting. They usually are in the back of the building. Near the stage, they come up with a lot of fun projects as well.
Muffy Schroeng still
she
do this.
She is. Muffy is great.
She is. She's wonderful.
Yes. And she's been around. She told me she's been around for quite a while running that program. So it's again, it's exciting to have folks back in the building. You know, last year it was my first year in this position, and it was really challenging. It was not an accurate depiction of what the program really offers. So this year was very, very busy. But it's been great. You know, we definitely want to continue to offer, you know, a variety of programs. So, we will be making announcements on some new programs shortly.
That's great.
Yeah, yeah, and you know, it's the city has so many wonderful spaces to do those programs, which is really nice.
Yeah.
Because sometimes that's a struggle.
Yes,
but we are blessed in this community, and the mayor yourself support all and maintain. That's I think the bigger thing, maintenance of all of these facilities.
I mean,
the parks and everything, very important.
As you're saying that, I'm just thinking like the space. You know, Forsyth Park, Hutton Park. Hutton Park's huge.
Yes, Hutton Park is.
Warren Park. I mean, there's more park space acreage in Kingston.
Yes.
Than any other town I can think of.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's huge.
We have a lot.
Beach is huge.
Yep.
Or, you know, the whole Forsyth, from, you know, the old J.C. Little League field all the way down to the pool.
Yeah.
That's like a mile. I don't know, but it's...
Yeah, it's a lot of parkland, absolutely. Yeah. And as you mentioned, maintenance is a big part of that.
By you?
Warren Park.
Warren Park.
Yes. Yep.
Warren Park, Hasbrook, Hutton.
Yep, we have Block.
Block.
Yep. And some of the, I just want to mention some of the
Barman.
Smaller ones. Yeah, Barman. Barman is one that people forget about.
Yeah, the Pocket Park, Raquel. Yeah. Knox,
Raquel.
Park.
Van Buren is another one.
Cornell.
Van Buren Street Park.
Oh, yeah.
Cornell also.
Cornell is big.
Yeah, Cornell. Yeah, and again.
Well, only half of Cornell.
Yeah, that's surprisingly big.
Like privately owned. Right?
Yes, there's a,
base in there.
Yeah. But there's a lot of gems,
big hunks of
Peace Park, the Peace Park right over on.
Yeah.
So we have a lot of little, you know, little gems that if you just stumble on them, it's.
Are you guys the Parks Rec Department? No, it's probably DPW. The around the new Rotary, that's DPW probably taking care of the grass and the trees. And
on Rotary? No, Rotary's Parks.
No, not Rotary Park. The new Rotary, the traffic circle.
Oh, the traffic
DPW,
circle.
Right?
Oh, so technically that is state property. So I
just say either way, you don't.
Yeah.
The DPW.
Yeah. The city. Yeah. But we try to collaborate and make sure that, you know, if something needs to get done, we all kind of work together to just make sure that happens. Yeah. Yeah.
And Rotary Park's a great park too. Yeah.
Rotary. Yeah.
With the walkway back.
Talk about
there.
Hidden. Yes.
That is.
Oh, the dog park, yeah.
Oh, yeah, and the point. Holy cow.
Yeah, there's a lot.
Wow.
Absolutely,
That's a lot of acreage.
It is. So I do want to mention our wonderful maintenance staff because they have their hands full every day, not to mention all the new trails that we have to take care of and very popular.
Oh, trail.
Yeah, wow, Empire buddy. State Trail. Yeah, so there's a lot going on in the parks and rec department there, but we have wonderful staff that just get the job done. They don't complain. They just want to make sure they do a good job for the community, so I have to give them props.
They
because,
use it, too.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. The it's their
in
community.
The park, the DPW are on the softball teams, and they play volleyball, and
they want they live here, they play here.
People on the DPW.
Yeah.
So it's great.
And the rail trails have been a wonderful addition.
Yeah.
The one down at Kingston Point.
Oh, yes.
Oh, my gosh. That's just really a beautiful walk, run, whatever anybody wants to do.
Yeah.
And then you have the rail trail that comes from the plaza.
Yes.
And that comes down Broadway.
Absolutely.
That's another great one.
And the goal is that they plan to connect all of it so that you can get from downtown all the way to uptown and you know, onto the Empire State Trail. It's really wonderful and it's coming together very nicely.
And that's all under your jurisdiction also, the rail trails?
Yeah, there's certain parts that it turns over into maybe the county's end or town of Ulster, Scenic Hudson, Hutton Brickyards. There's kind of different areas there where it kind of all connects into, you know, different sections.
So
but
part of it,
we are taking care of most of the maintenance on that. So, yeah.
Lindsey, I have a question
in
regard to all the programs that you have for the kids. Okay. And I'm just wondering what your interface is with Dan Whalen and the Boys and Girls Club is.
Yeah. Dan's great. Dan and I go way back. I will say that last year when we weren't able to offer summer camp, there was kind of like a coalition of different organizations that put together a youth enrichment program, which included Dan and the Boys and Girls Club. And so they, you know, while they have their own program, we tend to work together in different areas. Dan will try to, you know, put teams together for our biddy programs and flag football. We work together if we have any kind of joint, just overall community program effort. So, we do work closely together, and overall, we all have the same goal. So I think that's all that matters.
Are there any bicycling programs that you do, or?
Well, we have the Bike Kingston group. Tom Polk from the YMCA. He actually he serves a lot of our summer camp programs and after school programs. He does bike club.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So again, we all kind of come together, and you know, they offer different programs for us. You know, so it's
So we got 2 minutes left. Yes. Why don't you just, any deadlines coming up for enrollment or registration?
Yeah, so registration currently is open, like I said, for flag football right now. I think indoor volleyball is opening up soon for new players. I think right now returning players are starting to get their rosters in. We have not opened up for over 30 yet or Biddy yet, but right now, the Rondau Neighborhood Center after school program will be starting September 13th. Very important. One of our best programs, Andrew Williams, one of our other rec leaders, heads that at the Rondau Center. Gives kids a place to go after school, get some homework done, get something to eat, have a little recreation time, play some games. Sometimes there's field trips. You know, in normal years, there's field trips as well.
Yeah. And parents reach out to your office to sign their children up
absolutely.
For that. And do they get bused quickly from the schools? Do they get bused from the schools down the Roundout Center? Or how do the kids get down
It's
there?
Usually walking. Usually walking or drop off. Some parents do carpool and stuff. But yeah.
That's great. And Lindsey, just give us contact information one more time.
Absolutely.
Website.
Absolutely.
Phone number.
Yep. We can be reached at 481-7330. You can also find us on our website at kingston-ny.gov.
Great. Awesome. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, yeah.
A ton of information.
Yes.
And,
I know it's a lot.
Busy woman, that's for sure.
Yeah, keep up the good work.
Absolutely. And, thank you.
Yeah, we got to get you back on sometime, but maybe in the spring
Always.
For an update, or in the fall, rather.
Yeah.
Well, this is the fall. I meant the spring.
Yeah.
Give an update on the winter stuff.
Absolutely. Happy to be here.
Yeah.
Right, cool. Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, everybody. All right. Have a terrific Tuesday. Enjoy your week.
And we'll see you next week.
Yes.
All right,
Dan.
Take it away, Dan.
Perfect timing. 8:59. And thank you. Thank you so much, Lindsey Timbrook, for coming in with Director of Parks and Recreation, City of Kingston. Thank you so much for being in with us. And it's now 8:59 a.m., Tuesday, August 31st, and 66 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. This last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Rondout Savings Bank. Always working for you and the community with branches in Kingston, West Hurley, and Hyde Park. Also online at rondoutbank.com. Equal Housing Lender, Member FDIC. Thank you for being with us today and every weekday, 7 to 9 a.m. Please be with us. And thank you for sharing the morning with us. This is Kingston Community Radio, KCR, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, WGHQ, and our live streaming on mykcr.org. It is talk radio at its best, inspired discussions of, by, and for the community. And we invite you to be with us tomorrow morning for a Super Wednesday. Until tomorrow, we wish you every success in developing Kingston and all our neighboring communities. We now return you to Magic 92.5.